So an ANOVA or a Kruskal-Wallis test will generate one p-value. What does that p-value tell you? It will tell you if there's something going on in your data. But it will not tell you which group is different from which. So what is the ANOVA doing? It will calculate the variation between the groups. And it will compare the variation between the groups to the variation within each group. So if the variation between the groups is much higher than the variation within the groups, then the ANOVA will tell you there is something going on in your data. There is a difference in your data. But still, you will not know a lot because you will not know which group is different from which. If you want to know this, you have to do additional statistical tests after the ANOVA and after the Kruskal-Wallis test. More specifically, you will have to do pairwise comparisons. So you will have to compare all the pairs of samples. So in this example, you will have to compare the blue sample with the yellow one with the gray one, and the blue one with the gray one. And then you will know which group is different from which. So these pairwise comparisons are also called post hoc tests, or post tests, or follow-up tests. What is specific about these pairwise comparisons is that they are more sensitive than the original ANOVA, and you can see that easily here on the slide. So the ANOVA will calculate the variation between the groups here. So variation between blue and yellow, not so big. Variation between yellow and gray, not so big. Variation between blue and gray is big. Yeah, but these tune that down. That big variation that you see here. So overall, you will get substantial variation between the groups, but not as big than when you look only at blue and gray. And that's the difference, because the pairwise comparison will only look at blue and gray. So it's perfectly possible that the ANOVA will say that there's nothing going on in your data, while the pairwise comparison will say, yes, there is a difference between these two groups. So these post hoc tests, what are they? Well, for ANOVA, they're basically variations on a regular t-test. It's not exactly a t-test, but it looks a lot like a normal t-test. What is the main difference? There are more differences than the one that I'm going to mention, but the main difference is that you're going to do multiple testing correction. Why? Well, because you do multiple tests, multiple post hoc tests on the same data set. And each time that you do multiple tests on the same data, you have to correct for that. So, as I said, every time you do multiple, more than one test on the same samples, on the same data, you have to do a multiple testing correction. So I can imagine here three different cases where you have to do a multiple testing correction. So the first one is the follow-up tests after ANOVA. So we do an ANOVA, and after that ANOVA, we're going to do the pairwise comparisons. So we're going to compare wild type and mutant 1, and we're going to compare wild type and mutant 2. It means we're going to do two statistical tests that involve the wild type sample. We have to correct for that. Second case, where you have to do multiple testing correction. When you have a setup like this, you have a whole list of genes or proteins or metabolites, and for every gene, you measured its expression in this case in a set of control samples and a set of treated samples. And what you're going to do now is for every gene, you're going to compare the expression in the treated samples to the expression in the control samples. So for every gene, you're going to do a t-test. That means that in total, there are 10,000 genes here. You're going to do 10,000 t-tests, all involving this set of six samples. It means you have to do a multiple testing correction. And then the last example, suppose I have two sets of samples and I measure different things for these two sets of samples. A good example, for instance, is I think I found a drug treatment that works against COVID. What do? I take two groups of patients. One group gets my drug, the other group gets a placebo treatment. And then I'm going to measure to see if my drug has an effect. What am I going to measure? I could, for instance, measure the oxygen saturation in the two sets of patients and then compare the oxygen saturations of the two groups. Fine. But I could also measure the pain level in each group. I could measure the severity of coughing. I could measure the fever in the two groups. So I could measure multiple things here. And the more things that I measure and that I compare, the more likely it will be that I will find a difference between my control and my treated group just by chance. If, for instance, just by chance, all the tough patients are in the treated group, then I will find a difference in pain level between the two groups, but it's not because of my drug treatment. No, it's just because by chance, all the tough patients are in the treated group. So the more that I measure, the more likely it is that this will happen. And that's the reason why you have to do the multiple testing correction. Because for each individual test that you do, you allow a 5% chance on a false positive. And for one test, that's okay, eh? That's very low. 5% chance that it will give a bogus result, okay, you can live with that. But the more tests you do, the more likely it will become that this bogus result will happen. And that's the problem. For instance, here in this extreme case, where I'm testing 10,000 genes, I'm going to do 10,000 t-tests. If I allow a 5%, 5 out of 100, chance of false positives, it means that on these 10,000 tests, 500 will generate a false positive. So 500 of my differentially expressed genes will be a false positive. That's an enormous amount. How can you do that correction? Well, there are two ways to do that. First one is the Bonferroni correction. There are variations on the Bonferroni correction, but basically what they're all based on is the following. So you're going to increase your p-values to make them more stringent so that they are less likely to fall below this threshold of 5%. Because this threshold defines which p-value you're going to call significant, if it's below the 5%, and which p-value you're going to ignore, which is not significant. When do you use this type of correction? When you don't have a lot of tests that you do. So in the case of the follow-up tests after the ANOVA, you're only going to do two tests. That's not a lot, so you can do, or you should do, a Bonferroni correction here. Also, in this example, where I measure four different things that I'm going to compare, it's only four comparisons that I'm going to make, so I'm going to do a Bonferroni correction. The other method that you use for doing the correction is based on the false discovery rate. What does this mean? Well, normally, for every statistical test that you do, you allow a 5% chance of having a false positive. So 5% of all the tests that you do will be a false positive. Now, in a test that uses the false discovery rate, 5% of all the tests that give a significant p-value can be a false positive. So that's not 5% of all the tests, but only 5% of the tests that effectively give you a low p-value. So coming back on this example, in the first example where I say 5% of all the tests can be a false positive, I'm doing 10,000 tests, so I will get 500 false positives. In the second example where I set the false discovery rate to 5%, so if I have, for instance, in total 100 differentially expressed genes, then 5% of this 100 differentially expressed genes will be a false positive. So 5 of them. When do you use this one? When you do a lot of comparisons. Like in the example here where we do 10,000 t-tests. Then you go for the false discovery rate method. Why? Because in that case, the Bonferroni method is way too stringent. What post hoc test do you need to do after ANOVA? Well, it depends on the comparisons that you want to make. If you want to compare every group to every other group, you have to use a Tukey test. If you want to compare every group to one control, what we do here in this example, so we are going to compare every mutant to the wild type, but we're not going to compare the two mutants. So that's this case. Every group to one control, the wild type. Then you have to use a Dunnett test. If you're going to do a selected set of comparisons, so group 1 with group 2, and group 3 with group 4, and group 5 with group 6, but nothing else, if you're in that case, you're going to do a regular t-test, but with a correction. There are 3 different corrections here, but they're all based on the Bonferroni correction. So they will all make the p-values higher. The Bonferroni one is the most stringent one, so it will increase the p-values the most. So when you have done an ANOVA with a Welsh correction, because the spreads of the groups are not equal, you should follow that up with pairwise comparisons using the Gaimes-Howell test. Because that also doesn't assume that the groups have equal variance. After a Kruskal-Wallis test, you use a Dunn's test. So a specific post hoc test for ranked data. So that brings me to the question. So I have this data set, so a wild type and 2 mutants. So in each group I have 8 mice. So, and what I measured were the lengths of the exons of these mice. So that's what you see here, that's the data. So first of all, answer the question, what kind of data is this? Which type? I checked normality of the data using a D'Agostino and Pearson omnibus test. And these are the p-values that came out. So what can I conclude here? Are the data normally distributed or not? And then, next question, how can I check if the groups have equal variance? And do I need to check that?